Good afternoon, everybody. So welcome to this month Quantep seminar. Today, I have the pleasure to introduce to the speaker, which is Enrique Rico Ortega from the University of País Vascos. He's a Knickerbocker researcher, and today he will present some simulation strategies for lattice gauge theory. As usual, we will take your questions in the chat here on the or in the YouTube channel, and then Enrique will answer at the end of the talk. So, Enrique, welcome. The floor is yours. Okay.
Well, thanks a lot. So, first of all, thanks, Simone and Yasser, to give this opportunity, and I'm sharing already now the slides. I hope, can you see properly? Is it fine? Okay, perfect. So as Simone mentioned, I will talk about lattice gauge theories, and concretely about the simulation of this gauge theories in two different approaches that has been developed in the last years in quantum sciences. About tensor networks and about the simulation with a quantum simulator or a quantum computer. So in a broad sense, in a global view, what I want to transmit today is that there are really a fruitful dialogue between two big science research in physics. One is about high energy and nuclear physics, and the other is about quantum information science and technology. And this dialogue is in fact a two-way communication, helping problems of one with the tools of the other. Today we will specialize more bringing tools from quantum information to help in the problems of high energy physics, but the other way would be also possible. The words I'm going to describe are the work that I have been involved for a decade or so, but I wanted to point that ideas already in possibilities of describing or simulating high energy physics with some other means, already in some sense appears at the beginning of all these lattice gauge endeavor already in the 80s. For instance, there is a paper by Forster, Nielsen, and Ninomiya, and I always wanted to show that where they claim that we saw that the large distance behavior of gauge series is stable with a certain limit with respect to addition of gauge non-invariant interaction at a small distance. And why this is relevant and concerned in our simulation with quantum platform is because maybe there are some addition of this gauge non-invariant interaction in this platform, but still the physics that we are going to recover is stable against these small perturbations. And that's why I wanted to focus to put this is the first paper in here already from the 80s. As I said, the thing that I wanted to discuss are a project that has been involved during the last decade, starting when I was doing a postdoc in the group of Peter Solet in Innsbruck. And there we start all this endeavor of the simulation of lattice gauge theories with quantum technologies. There also I was working with Marcello Dal Monte, with Simone Montangero, and some of the work that we were doing since then. I will try to describe it in here. Luckily, or not only, there was a European effort in this sense, but also the US people now is also joining forces. And there are already some papers and some review papers in this direction from the US from the US collaborations. As I said, there are also some other reviews from Marcello, from Simone, from Ignacio and Eresoar or Benedetic, or also from Fis. All of this is taking care of the different approaches that has been done since then for these quantum simulations, quantum technologies. Finally, and just I wanted to spot three papers that are also relevant, but I'm not going to tell in detail. One is a experimental realization of a possible realization of these models with superconducting circuits. It was done in collaboration with the group of Chris Wilson in Canada, and was a superconducting ladder. emulating what's going on in bosonic in a cross ladder. This is important for the description of modes that appear at the edge of this system that are chiral modes, and this is important to describe chiral physics or chiral fermions in the lattice. I'm not going to talk in detail, but this is already something that has been already realized in the lab in the group of Chris Wilson in Waterloo, Canada. Many of the things I'm going to tell you about tensor networks has been done in collaboration with Simone and with Pietro, and here is probably the most recent review that we have about these issues, and I just want to spot it in here. And the last I wanted to also to show is, as I tell you, there is a two-way communication between these two big research lines in physics, from high energy and from quantum information. And here is that the tools or definitions that appears in high energy physics, and especially about the symmetries, can help in understanding the robustness of some qubits that appears in the now specifically in superconducting circuit that's called the 0.5 qubit. So as I said, today we're going to talk about tools from quantum information helping high energy models, but also there are tools or definitions, for example, about symmetry properties and anomalies concretely in high energy physics that could help to understand the robustness of some qubits that appears, for instance, in superconducting circuits and this 0.5 qubit. I only wanted to spot in here as an advertisement, but we are not going to enter into the details of these works. So, what is going to be the take-home message of the talk of today? I wanted to, if I have time, I wanted to talk about three different aspects of this this endeavor, or this quantum simulation of these lattice gauge models. The first is the that we have an exact description of gauge immanent subspace with tensor network state. I wanted to show you that this is the case, and thanks to this description with tensor networks, we can show that we can realize real-time evolution. This would be the first message I want to convey today. Second, and now we are talking about quantum simulators, we will show how to quantum simulate not local matrix elements that are Wilson loops in space and real time. And this is, I will show you, this is really important for the description of the scattering in particle physics. This type of matrix elements appears in these scattering processes. And we will show how a quantum simulator, once we have it, can assess this type of non-local matrix elements. And third, if time allow us, I will talk you a bit, just comment about quantum state preparation in this business. And we will show how a variation, and more importantly, low-depth circuits can prepare the lowest energy state of gauge invariant circuit. And I stress that it's a low-depth circuit because it's an important issue nowadays in this era, that we don't have complete control of all the elements in our circuits, so for SD coherence, and this is an important issue in this how to prepare these states, but with low depth circuits. So let's start from the first part. Just two slides about the overviews about tensor networks for the people that they haven't seen it, but. Two slides about this overview. So what are these tensor networks? This is a variational method for a Hamiltonian system, and that has been extremely used in one-dimensional systems under the name of MPS and an algorithm that's called DMRG. It starts with the condensed matter in the 90s, 2000, I think it was the beginning of DMRG. Since then, and starting with the quantum information studies of understanding this type of algorithm, there has been an extension and explosion of ideas, and there are proposals in higher dimensions. This is called three tensor networks, for instance, that Simon is working on this, or MERA, or PEPS, and in general, it's called tensor network states. Well, by the way, what I'm going to tell you is a work that we were doing with Simone, but that related work also in Munich, in Vienna, or in Barcelona with Levenstein, Ignacio, and Frank Straete. Basically, with these variational states, what the people has been managed to achieve is the ground state physics of this condensed matter of high energy models, low energy excitation, thermal states, and more importantly, because this is bottlenecks in some other methods like Monte Carlo, they have addressed time evolution, and there are proposals to study fermionic systems. This is an important issue in this context. So as a definition, these tensor networks is just a class of Taylor variational unsat state on a lattice for a many-body quantum system. In general, a many-body system is written in a basis of a local of your local system. Imagine there's just you have a spins or whatsoever other Hilbert space, and then you have a wave function depending on the local Hilbert space. What is the purpose of these tensor networks? And we will fix our attention in matrix product states, but similar is for any other dimension. Is to write down this wave function, but with the matrices. At the end, the wave function is just obtained by contacting these smaller tensors with these ancillary indices in these matrices. Graphically, then, what we have is our state, that is the site, is just built out of the contraction of these matrices A that I'm putting in here, and this A is just the MPS construction. And if we contract all these indices, at the end of the day, we obtain the upside, the wave function that we want. Why this construction is useful? Why this construction is useful is because they are really well suited to describe translational invariant states. Once, for instance, if you have all the matrices that the same matrix, then you have by definition a translational invariant state. In one dimension, they encode what is called the tropic boundary area. That is, you can easily see what is called this balance bound state picture. They are optimal to minimize the energy. This was at the beginning of in the condensed matter world where appear these things under the name of the energy methods. And especially, it's very simple to extract any expectation value because we can construct always a transfer matrix out of these matrices to get the expectation value of any operator that we want. These are the reasons why this method is working so well. Okay, so we have already the definition of our states. Now, what that has to do? These states with the description or with the simulation of a gauge invariant model. And now let me go really general in the gauge invariant model and see how this language of this matrix product state fit with the gauge invariant models. For a gauge invariant model, we will need a link variable, a parallel transporter that is seated on the link of our lattice between two vertices x and y. And usually, it's going to happen that this link operator is going to be described by two modes, that is a left and right mode, because we need some left and right properties of these links. In general, as I said, in a non-abelian model, this link will carry some color index. This color index is this ij index. If we don't have any indices, it's just the U1 model. And if it has two possible values, it's the U2. If it has three possible values, it's the U3. So this is in general, we have some link variables, some color indices connecting the vertex X and vertex Y. As I said, we will need some particular definition of this link operator with some basic some properties of the action of some transformation acting on the left and on the right. And because of this, we need these two modes that I was pointing at the upper part of the slide. Would decompose the link with these two modes in the left and on the right. This generator of the transformation on the left and right act in this form against our link, just making some transformation with the color indices acting on the left or acting on the right. And these are the important transformations that is in this going on with these link operators. Okay. So why is this important? Is because this is the basis to construct our gauge invariant physics. We will need now some generator, this transformation under which our states is they are gauge invariant. So this gauge generator is basically the Gauss law, and the physical condition is that the Gauss law is fulfilled. So the generator acting on our physical states is equal to zero. For instance, in quantum electrodynamics, just the divergence of the electric field is equal to the charge of the system. And finally, we have to define some Hamiltonian, and this is a commute with this generator of this transformation. And for instance, is this the case? So this is by definition our type of Hamiltonian that we are going to deal with. Okay, a Hamiltonian that has these symmetry properties, and from the other side, we have these matrices that I was telling you to describe our quantum system. Let's mix these two things and see that they come together and they are more or less easily to fit together one to with another. So as I said, the state has to fulfill some Gauss law, some gauge invariant property. So we have a generator of these transformations on our physical states. we define it a physical state, the one that are annihilated by this generator. As I said, in quantum electrodynamics, for example, is just the divergence of the electric field is equal to the charge at every point on the lattice. And this is something that is affecting, as you see here, the vertex where is sitting the matter field and the links where is affecting the electric field. So this operation here is affecting our two links around the vertex and a vertex. If we know that these links we encode it with some left and right modes, in fact, what is going to happen is that this property here about the gate generator is affecting only the mode that is touching or close to the vertices on the left or on the right side. And this is going to carry this Gauss law. There will be some extra constraint to form our link operator on the links between this left and right operator. There's an extra constraint that has to be fulfilled. So all in all, what is going to happen is that the Gauss condition on our states will define our physical Hilbert space. There will be a set of states that is affecting just the matter and these modes on the link. And we will have some extra condition about the modes that are coming to the links. This extra condition is just the product of this, can be encoded in a product on the contraction between the states around the vertices. So at the end of the day, we can have an exact description of a gauge invariant subspace just with this tensor network states. And in fact, so the A operator is giving us which is the physical Hilbert space, and the contraction between these matrices, what is giving us this extra condition on the link between the modes that are building our link. So this is an exact description, and we know for sure that these states fulfill the Gauss law and are the only possible gauge invariant states in our state. Why now is this useful? If we have this description, it's because now we can tackle many problems in the description of gauge invariant models. For instance, we can tackle things about imaginary time evolution, so to describe a phase diagram. And we have been doing in the last years, for instance, the description of CP symmetry breaking in the Schwinger model with a background electric field. We have described in the finite density phase diagram for SU2 model, this invariant Fermi-Hubbard model. Importantly, and I will enter in more detail about real-time evolution, in fact, about Quench experiment, the dynamical characterization of the dynamical stream breaking. I will tell you more in detail about this in a second. And also, this can be used as a model building, all these things about the matrix product state. And for that, for instance, we study one particular model that has this chiral symmetry breaking. We call it a nuclear fission in an SO3 gauge invariant model. And it's just because of understanding the structure of this gauge invariant states. As I said, now we are going to enter a bit more in the description of this real-time dynamics with this MPS. And for that, we will use just the simplest QED model in 1+1 dimension with Stargardt fermions. And this is Stargardt fermions is to describe the vacuum of a fermion C. We will have some electric field term with some coupling constant. We will have the matter gauge in coupling. This is the hopping of the fermions mediated by the gauge boson, and then we'll have the Stargardt mass because of this Stargardt fermions in the system. For the representation of the Hilbert space of this of the different degrees of freedom of the matter field, we will have just the empty or occupied of our matter site. While for the gauge field, we will use a spin one representation. We will have one state that will be the vacuum, and one state if it's pointing to the left, the electric field flux. We will call it -1, and if pointing to the right, we will call it +1. For instance, we can start with a vacuum reference state that is just the strong coupling of this Hamiltonian. And for instance, it's just this Stargardt distribution of the matter with the vacuum on the link of our system. And out of this reference state, for instance, we can create a pair of a quark-anti-quark pair just using the hopping, the minimal coupling of the matter field mediated by the gauge boson. And in this form, we can create, for instance, this pair of quark-anti-quark in the system. So why is this useful? It's because now with this PER anti-PER pair that we create in the system, we can stretch or enlarge this string. This string will have an energy depending on the distance between the particle and antiparticle because of the electric term that we have in the Hamiltonian. This increasing will be linear with this distance. This is a notion in 1D, it's a bit tricky, but it's a notion of confinement of these particles. And if you enlarge too much this string, at the end, there is so much energy in the system that the system prefers to create some hadron. This is called string breaking and hadronization, and you will have mesons at the edge of this string, depending on the length of the system. This is just a cartoon picture of what is happening, but in a real simulation, where we can extract these things via the description or the characterization the electric field that is carrying on in this system, and also I will tell you in a second about the entangling properties of this string. And here what we see is that initially we start with vacuum on the left and the right side of the system. We prepare a string in the middle and we let it evolve the system. And what is going to appear is first appears this vacuum. First we will have this string that is evolving. And then, let me see, okay. There will be, there will appear what is called, we call it a string of pairs. And then there will be a situation here in that will have this complete breaking of the string with the formation of the meson at the end of the strings. Then we will have a bouncing of pairs, anti-pairs, we call it, and anti-strings. And at the end, we will have this bouncing back and forth and the evolution of the string in the system. As I said, we can characterize completely this evolution via both a figure of merit. First is the electric field spreading of the system and also the entanglement propagation. This is a fair example that we have characterized using MPS. A second, for instance, is also a meson scattering where we prepare two mesons some distance apart. We let it evolve such that they scatter. They go to some common pond. They will scatter and they will evolve again. This scattering we can characterize by the electric field that is happening in the system or the entanglement that appears during the scattering. So this is the first message that I wanted to convey today. Please tell me about time, Simone. Okay. The second that I wanted to tell you is about the quantum simulations, quantum simulator of this system with the in a quantum platform. And for this, I wanted to convey this the work that we have been doing here in the Basque Country with Miguel Echevarria, Iñigo Urquiza, and Gunnar Sleth. And this is a quantum simulation of light from particle calculators. I'm not going to enter into detail how to emulate or to create the minimal coupling. So the term in the Hamiltonian that is the hopping of the matter field mediated by the Gates boson. There has been already some discussions about these things. For instance, in the reviews I was pointing at the beginning, there are explicit descriptions of this type of term, how can be emulated with quantum simulators on a quantum computers. But basically, there are three measures or three ways to do these things. First is by energy penalty, because usually you don't start with Hamiltonians that has this type of interaction. You start with Hamiltonians that has similar interaction, but you penalize anything that is not gauge invariant. By this energy penalty, you know for sure that in the low energy behavior, what you recover is just this minimal coupling of the matter field mediated by the gauge boson. Another way is, although you don't have the symmetry, this gauge symmetry that you have in your system, you will have some other internal symmetry that you can use it to emulate the symmetries, the local symmetries of the system that you want to This is basically useful, or this is really useful for the non-abelian system. And for using this internal symmetry, we managed to show how non-abelian can be also emulate this minimal coupling in the lattice. Can be emulating this in quantum simulator. And the third way that has been proposed to try to do this minimal coupling is via some encoding, such that you are always working with gauge invariant degrees of freedom, so you know for sure that the dynamic that you will recover is gauge invariant. But I'm not going to enter into this detail. As I told you, I please go to the reviews I was citing at the beginning. But let's have in mind now our primitive gate, our primitive interaction that we managed to do in our simulator, in our quantum computer, is just this matter gauge interaction. We have this minimal coupling. Then what can we do with this type of interaction? What to do? So the first thing that we can do is to go to one of these big colliders, these big lab that are available nowadays, and try to see what is going on there and just emulate the physics that is going on there. So for instance, we can prepare some state that we will call it in our register that is going to be our electron state, some other many body system. It's going to be a many body system that we will call it a proton state. We will make it interact. We will smash them, and we will see what is the product out of this scattering. Obviously, this is a brute force experiment, and it's really following what's going on already in these big colliders. But from the people in QCD and the people in the lattice QCD, we know that this type of structure, this type of scattering process has a lot of structure. And probably it's not needed to follow from the beginning, from the as I said, building our wave function of the electron, building our wave function of the proton, smash them and see what's going on, because we can see several structures, several layers in this scattering process, and go just with the layer that particularly now is more difficult for classical simulations. And this several levels of layer and this structure that appears in this scattering process is comes with the name of factorization theorems in this in QCD. More or less, for the calculation of this cross section, this factorization theorems tell us that there are several factors in this cross section that not all of them are difficult to calculate. There are some of them that they are already calculable by perturbative QCD calculations, but there are some of them that are more difficult to be calculated. They are non-perturbative. And this non-perturbative matrix element, this is what the ones that are called PDF, TMTs, and so on. And we'll have also some correction because of energy. But what is the definition of this matrix element? This matrix element is nothing but, apart from some sums and integrals, it's just the expectation value is a matrix element or some reference state. Here is a proton state, but can be a vacuum state, can be some other initial state. And then basically what you have in the middle is a Wilson line. Is the creation and annihilation of some matter field mediated by some strings of gauge bosons. So this is a Wilson line with some reference state in space and in real time. So it's non-local both in space and real time. And these matrix elements, these non-local matrix elements, are the ones that you need to describe this cross section. And obviously, they are the ones that are not perturbative and that they are the ones really difficult to obtain with ab initio methods. So what we want to study how to extract this type of non-local matrix element, this Wilson line, so Wilson loops that are non-local in space and in real time. So how to do these things? Which are the requirements that we need to for the quantum simulation of this matrix element, this what is called PDS Parton correlators? First of all, we need to encode the quantum degrees of freedom, both of matter and gauge field. And as I told you already in the simulator, there are ways to encode this. The matter field will be in the vertices, the gauge field will be on the links, and then we will have some interaction between them. We will need to prepare some reference states, as I told you, some proton states, some vacuums, some glue ball. This, for the moment, let's put it aside and let's see that let's accept that we can do these things. Later on, I will at the end of the talk, I will comment about these things if I manage to have time about these things. But this is an important issue in the whole strategy. Third, obviously, we need to simulate the gauge invariant interaction. But this we have already accepted as given. This is the minimal gauge matter coupling. So this is the minimal coupling. And fourth is the study that we want to get, the real-time evolution and of this Wilson data and local, both in space and in time. Finally, about measurements, I'm not going to enter, but stay with me that this, once you achieve all the other points that I have before, this is more or less easy, it's a kind of quantum interferometer. So the measurement of this type of processes can be obtained. Okay, so what we are going to follow is the what is called the digital approach for these quantum simulators. And what we, in this digital approach, what you can have in mind is that you have some initially some register in your machines. You apply some gates to describe the evolution of your system. And at the end of the day, so you have some final register that is the result of all this, your evolution. This is the usual thing in quantum computers, but also in the simulators. This, if you want, comes with the name of a stroboscopy simulator, it is analog simulator. So both in the quantum computers or in analog simulators, this type of architecture in principle can be built and can be constructed. What we have in mind is just, let's take the simplest Wilson line that we can think in the space and time. It's going to be a Wilson loop. So as a Wilson loop, there is only gauge degrees of freedom that is closing some trajectory in the space and time. The space is the one that is parallel to the screen, and the time is something that is goes opposite to the screen, and we have some evolution in the space and time. So what we could propose is that to discretize both space and time, space as in the lattice, and the lattice QCD, and time in the evolution of this digital evolution of our quantum simulator. So at the end of the day, we will have this discretization of the space and time, and at the end of the day, we have we build our Wilson loop that we want to build. How to do this in practice? Let's start first from the spatial constructions of our Wilson lines. Then we will let it evolve in time, and we will see how slowly we will build our Wilson loop. So to build our Wilson loop in the space is something that we have already seen more or less in this stream breaking. So we will start with some reference states and vacuum state of this of our system. We will just use this minimal coupling, this hopping of the matter mediated by the Gauge boson, and apply it once to this reference state. What we have is the minimal Wilson line attached between two sides, between the first and the second side. We will start with some, call it reference state and Meson state, and as we did it with the stream, so we will enlarge this by sequential application of this minimal coupling, this the primitive gate that we have, this the minimal coupling of the gauge of the matter field mediated by the gauge boson. So at the end, we will build our stream in the space. So they will have a bunch of link operators between some matter degrees of freedom that is our register of the color indices, but we will have already our Wilson line built it in the space. How to evolve it now in time? We just have to evolve this system in time with the Hamiltonian of the lattice QCD or some other Hamiltonian. We have some of the gauge invariant Hamiltonian. We will follow just the simpler strategy of the composing our Hamiltonian in Trotter-Suzuki approximation. This is an efficient approximation to build our evolution. We know this from the work of the Sergio at the beginning of all this business of quantum simulation in the 90s. And we will decompose, for instance, simply the electric and the magnetic and the magnetic term in sequential gates in our simulator. In this form, we will have our evolution in time. So we will build our string in space, we let it evolve in time. Probably we will evolve again in space, we let it evolve in time, evolve in the space, evolve in time, and we will close it in the space. Just as this procedure I was telling you, we will have described it in our work for any model, abelian and non-abelian, continuous models. But just for the proof of principle, we fix our attention to show that this is working in the simplest possible scenario. They set to pure gauge theory, and we compare this Trotter decomposition with the continuous time of these Wilson loops in space and time. We take this cross configuration of our gauge degrees of freedom, and we let it evolve our Wilson loop in this configuration, and we take just two figures of merit, that is the operator norm and the ground state fidelity, to compare, as I said, between the continuous time and the trotterized version. And we see, and this is quite important, with a small number of trotter steps, around 10, we already achieve good fidelities for this type of processes. And well, this is already an important issue about this with low circuits, low depth circuit, we achieve with fidelities. And if time is how I'm doing with some minutes, perfect. And now, just to close the, as I said, the third message that I wanted to convey today is about the something that I was hiding a bit about this, the preparation of this measuring these Parton correlators, was the preparation of gauge invariant states in a quantum simulator. This is preparation of a quantum state in general is one of the most difficult problems for a quantum computer, a quantum simulator in particular. In fact, it is known that is in this it is called this QMA problems, and this is the analog of MP problems in the quantum world. So in the most general case, is we know for sure that it's going to be a difficult task. Even and it's going to be the case about the model we are going to deal with, that to build a ground state with unitary circuit, the depth of this unitary circuit sometimes or usually is going to scale with the system size of the system that we have. And there are topological reasons about these things that have been discussed by Radia Hastings in the slide at the beginning of the 2000. So which is the type of model I want to discuss? Again, is the most simple scenario, but this is a non-trivial scenario to check how to get the low energy state in these quantum simulators. We are going to deal with the set-2 gauge invariant model. This is already a non-trivial model in 2+1 dimension, has a plaquet interaction, some electric field terms, and local term. And as I said, it's not trivial because we have a phase transition between confined and the confined phases with some critical point with the order of 3 in this the coupling constant of the plaquet term. By the way, the confined phase in this probably you already know in this model is already has a topological order. By the way, just to mention this, we are doing here in the Basque Country with Jesús Cobos, but this is a collaboration with people in Madrid, Alejandro Bermúdez, and people in Aachen, David Loher and Marcus Müller. So what do we have in mind? How to prepare this state with low depth circuit? This is important. We want to prepare this in not in something that is scaled with the system size, but something that in few steps you can already have your ground state prepared and loaded in your quantum computer. So what we are going to take is some variational state that was already defined at the very beginning of the lattice QCD business by John Cardin and Hammer in the 80s. They study this state as a variational state of the set-2 gauge model. What is this? This state is simply starting with all the states on the link in a plus state, is a negative state of the electric field, and just apply the plaquet interaction, the magnetic interaction, to this state. This state already has two states that are exact states of this Hamiltonian, and they are the two limits of the Hamiltonian. The first one is with the lambda equal to zero. Obviously, it's because just is the again state of the sigma x, that it was our electric filter. So obviously, this is an exact again state for lambda equal to zero. And for lambda really big, is also a ground state of the system, and it's just defined by this projector of the plaquet term against this state. Also, and we can check that this state is a gauge invariant model. The gauge generator for this Hamiltonian is just the product around the vertices of the Pauli's X around the vertices, and this is already full. This is can be checked easily that this is a gauge invariant state for this model. So now what we have to do is just to build this state, this variational state, on our quantum computer as a first approximation to the ground state of our system. It's not going to be the ground state, but it's going to be a first approximation. We will see later how we're going to modify these things. So how to do these things? This has been already proposed more or less for the limit of the topological order called the Kitaev model, when the lambda is really big. This was already proposed, I think, the literature appears several times. Tagliacozzo and Vidal has worked in this direction, and nowadays also Navat and Berresen is working in this direction, in the limit, as I said, of the Kitaev model. We extend this for the whole phase of the set-2 gauge model. So we start with some state of the placket, of the state of the placket. And for every state of the placket, we have some ancilla that will encode this beta parameter we have in our state. So starting with the state on the placket and some state in the ancilla, we make a rotation in the ancilla with a parameter that encodes, as I said, the value of the beta value that we need for interaction in the placket. Okay. Once we have this first step done, we go down to some control interactions in the system. Control set interaction in the system between the ancilla and the placket. So at the end of the day, and this is the important thing in here, this equation that we have in here, at the end of the day, we know for sure that the system has evolved to something that is practically what we want, because it's beta and the placket interaction, if the ancilla is in the plus state, and something that is minus beta and the placket interaction if the ancilla is in the minus state. So now if we measure the ancilla and we obtain a plus, we know for sure that we are in the state that we want to. So we achieve the state, as I said, as a first step, the variational state that we want, the state of Cardan. But if we obtain the minus state, we know that here we have a minus sign. But now thanks to the properties or the Pauli sigma set with respect to the sigma set, that is just changing the value of the placket, what we can do is just to act with a sigma x on one of the links, and at the end of the day, what is going to happen is we are going to change just the sign of the placket that we have in the exponent, and at the end of the day we recover again deterministically, and this is quite important because it's a non-variational circuit, but it's going to be deterministical, 100% probability, we end up in this state. As I said, this is the first approximation of our ground state. Now what we propose is to do a unitary evolution, so some layers of small evolutions in the system such that closer and closer to the state of our ground state. And it's just depending on the placket interaction again and the electric field. So this is the placket, the magnetic field, and the electric field term. And this is going to be some layers that they are going to be unitary evolutions. So we have as a first scenario the non-unitary part that approaches to the state that we want, and then just fluctuations, unitary fluctuations with some layers that will get us closer and closer to the ground state that we want. Well, the plots I'm going to show you just require two layers, one layer that is the non-unitary and one layer of unitary. And with these just two layers of non-unitary, even in system of 6 times 6 lattices in the two dimension, we have fidelities of around 98%. Probably fidelities is the figure of merit that is that gives you all the possible errors in the system, but checking some other figure of merit, we can see about the quality, thermodynamical quality of the state that we have achieved. And for instance, what we want to see are the thermodynamical quantities in the system, more than about the fidelity, but things about about the magnetization, things about the critical exponent or the critical properties of the system that we can achieve, as I said, just with two layers of this non-unitary and unitary part. So for that, we look about these thermodynamical quantities, we look about the magnetization, we make some finite scaling with our system, with system of 4 times 4, 5 times 5, and 6 times 6, and at the end, we recover a critical exponent and critical points that are comparable with the Monte Carlo calculations. So we already see that the state that we achieve has already is close to the our ground state. It has the thermodynamical quantities of the system that we want to achieve. Also, as I said, this system in the when lambda is really big, we are closer to the Kita F model and has topological properties. We can check also about the entanglement properties of this model, and we recover this EBIT of the entanglement in the wave function. So we also have the topological properties of the system. And even more, and this is more important because of this next era, as I said, we have two layers, one unitary and one non-unitary, and we check how to do, how this procedure happens with noisy gates. If you are in the scenario where you don't have noise, obviously, the more unitary that you put, so you have the non-unitary, and the more unitary that you put in your system, the closer and closer, or the better and better, you are going to go to your to the ground state. This is in the noiseless scenario. If we have not, probably putting more and more layers in the system is not going to make you go better to the ground state, but to take you away because of the noise. So we want to check is what is the probability, what is the ratio of this noise, such that putting more and more gates will allow us to have better and better accuracies in our ground state. And here is more or less where we plot these things. Here is the probability of noise on our gates versus some ground state energy of the system. And we see that already around one per thousand is the probability that we need to achieve this fault tolerance, if you want, in some sense, so that if you have this probability of noise, putting more and more layers in your system, what we will make you is to have better and better resolution of your ground state physics. And with that, let me finish with the initial slide that I was telling you about the three take home messages that I wanted to convey today. So first, the first thing that I was trying to describe to you today is that we have an exact description of gauge invariant states with tensor networks, and this allows us to do the real-time evolution of these systems. Second, that in the scattering in particle physics is quite important to get some matrix elements that are non-local, both in space and time. These are called these Parton correlation functions. We have shown how to extract this value and these correlators from quantum simulators. And third, and this is just working still in preparation that we are doing with, as I said, in Madrid and in Aachen, is the quantum state preparation with this quantum circuits and using unitary and non-unitary terms in these quantum circuits. And we have somehow a low-depth circuits can prepare the lowest energy state of this gate series. So with this, so I finish here and I'm happy to answer any question that you have.
Thank you very much, Enrique, for this very inspiring talk. So virtual applause. Are there any questions in the audience? So please, we have a first one. Just unmute yourself. Go ahead.
Hello. Thank you very much for the very interesting talk. I wanted to know if... have you tried, or do you think that it would be possible to simulate the swarm of soft, for instance, gluons, which is very interesting and happens in the very high energy collision between hadrons?
What is exactly what you want to simulate? Soft gluons.
It's what is called Carolus condensate, and it happens when in the high energy colliders, they are formation of a sort of swarm of low energy gluons, which make a sort of condensate. I don't know if this your method can be used, for instance, for simulating that situation.
In principle, the what we are proposing here is a way to extract a matrix element of these Wilson loops and Wilson lines. So if you are telling me that you have some glue, probably involved some measuring some Wilson type of operator. So for that, I will tell you first that in principle we can adapt this to the thing that you want. I don't have the details. I don't know exactly what you were telling me about this type of condensates, but in principle, if it's related to extract information out of these Wilson lines and Wilson loops, this could be done.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments? Verifications.
So, hi, Eric. Maybe I have a question. So, you computed this Wilson loops in space and time, so light front, by doing a Plaquette in space, Plaquette in time. So, is that necessary for the kind of quantity that you want to extract in this factorization theorems, or is it a choice that you made?
Well, at the end of the day, In a gauge invariant model, in a gauge invariant theory, all the correlators that you need to extract are gauge invariant correlators. So obviously, local mass density, for instance, is a gauge invariant correlator. Wilson light in space are also gauge invariant correlators. But what was not proposed in this work is this issue of this matrix element that are non-local both in space and time. And it's not only a fancy thing that we want to compute and to show that the quantum simulators can achieve, but it's something that appears and is needed in the description of these correlators. There is a whole industry in particle physics to extract these pattern correlation functions. Nowadays, there are basically two strategies to do these things. Is one, Monte Carlo, that they are more or less starting to extract data nowadays, and the other is just fitting experiment, just phenomenological. So ab initio is really difficult to extract these things because Monte Carlo obviously cannot do things about the real-time evolution. So something that it was needed.
I see. So it was not just to show that you can do it, but it's something that is actually required to. Okay. Nice.
Yeah. Thanks.
Any other comment, questions? So I would have a clarification and a provocative question, maybe. So the first one is, at the end, the layer of unitaries is adjusted variationally, minimizing the energy, or so that's what you're doing. It's
really if you want, is to do this QAO algorithms,
yeah,
but with non-unitary circuits. And this is the nice thing because this non-unitary part puts you in the phase that you want to arrive. And then the unitary part is just making you fluctuation within the phase. So you are already in the phase, but then with the unitary part, you are going closer and closer to the state that you want to arrive.
I see. Yeah. Okay. And the more provocative one is this nice idea. I mean, this idea is very nice. Now, what would be needed to produce results that are really useful for computing this scattering, this matrix element? So
about resources and so on. So it depends also about the type of machines that we are think of. There are numbers there that about the quantum computers, but. The people usually also said that in quantum simulation, probably they will be the first to that we will obtain some figure, some quantitative analysis of this system. So it first it depends on the machine that you have. It's more quantum computer and you analyze about these gates, about the qubit that you need, or it's about the quantum simulator that is emulating more your system. And there are people that already has done some simulation of these things, but we are really far away from this. For instance, there are, I want to mention a work has been done from in Berkeley, but it's just for instance in a quantum computer, just three side problem with a 5-4 theory. So obviously there are many things that are still needed in the way, but we are in the way.
Great. So if Matteo, are there any questions on YouTube?
Nope, no questions.
No questions. Okay, so I think we can thank Enrique again. And
thanks to you.
And Raffaella, if you can put the slides. Yes, so let me conclude this session thanking all the scientific organizing committee, Esther Omar, Andrei Zambainis, João Seixas, and Saverio Pascazio, and then, of course, Raffaello and Matteo that makes this thing possible. And let me announce next month Quantep seminar, which will be delivered by Alessandro Ruggiero from Trento University on quantum simulations of neutrino oscillations. Thank you very much. Have a nice evening or morning, depending on your time zone. Goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.